Now, follow-up question to the previous one. Please see my previous video, Data Science Interviews and Questions from a Practical Standpoint, Part 1. This is Part 2 of the series. Now, how do you go about selecting important variables, important features? And that's a very good question to have in order to understand your depth in data science field. But please note that the feature selection is an art and a measure of one's experience in data mining field. A good business understanding of the data is the key here. Now, the first step is eliminate correlated variables. That means, like, for example, length, width, and height given along with the area as a field. Now, area can be calculated as a product of these three fields. So you can eliminate length, width, and height and just use area. Now, this is known as dimensionality reduction as well, in where we look at numerical and categorical variables can be eliminated using correlated variables. And for categorical, we can also use G-squared test. The principal component analysis is also, you know, it's important to understand the variance in the data set as well. And then please note that the dimensionality reduction and PC are very closely related to each other. And also when you're looking at linear regression, you would also look at the variables based on the p-values. And finally, understand the trends of the variable, target variable, how other features are affecting the trend. And always applying a good business understanding is going to be the key. Talk to the people. When you go to a project where you are doing a machine learning work, you know, talk to the project, talk to the business, understand how they use the data elements. That can also be a good starter. Well, move on to the next one. What are the advantages and disadvantages of decision tree? And it's very simple. So decision trees are very easy to interpret. They are robust and, you know, they don't always look for linearity in the data set. But the disadvantages is they are very prone to overfitting the data. And that is a problem which can be solved by a random forest and, you know, the other type of trees, like boosted trees. Now, this is a scenario-based thing. Given a scenario, your decision trees seem to be working better as compared to time series algorithm. What do you infer? Now, this can be a hypothetical question. So decision trees are working better than time series algorithm. What do you detect out of it? And one simple straight line would be that looks like the data set is non-linear. It doesn't have seasonality. And the reason is the decision trees, as I said, mentioned in the previous slide as well, the decision trees fit better as compared to time series on non-linear transactions or data. Now, assuming that you are given a huge data set, let's say 500 features, which is huge, with 2 million records, and also assuming that you do not have an unlimited memory, how do you go about understanding and applying machine learning and deep learning algorithm? Please note that the interviewer understands what he's asking, and he's more looking how you are going to approach it. You know, many a times when I ask this question to a person or an interviewee, you know, the first one would be, you know what, I'm going to increase the RAM. It's not going to happen, correct? So think about how you approach this problem. Now, stochastic gradient descent models, the first one, because they predict with one record, maybe a set of records at a time. It doesn't have to wait for 2 million records to be processed before it can start applying hypotheses. And that is where, you know, the stochastic gradient model could be a good starting point. Now, again, eliminate correlated variables. Again, as I mentioned in the previous video, dimensionality reduction in order to, you know, decrease the number of features. And finally, randomize the sample data set. You don't have to really work with 2 million records. You know, for starters, you know, get a smaller data set, let's say 10 to 20% of records. For 2 million records, 20 to 400K, if your RAM is able to support that, pick up 500,000 and then go on increasing. And once you're ready to be deployed, obviously, there would be a lot of testing which you have to do. Next is, what is your approach in case of missing values? Now, it's a big problem. Data quality in data science is the biggest, one of the biggest problems you can think of. So assuming that 20% of the values are missing, how are you going to solve that? There is no right answer, like to keep them or remove them, how to do that. So when you have a missing value in the data set, assign a unique category. For example, assign a category saying that any unique values would be category this, and then see how the target variable is distributed on that missing category. Now, if there is a link or if there is an apparent pattern, then obviously you cannot afford to remove the missing values. Now, how would you compare the correlation between continuous and categorical variable? This is a very simple question. So the best answer I can think of is use ANCOVA. I repeat, use ANCOVA, which is analysis of covariance technique. Now, on the same lines, how do you differentiate between covariance and correlation? Please note that correlation is the standardized form of covariance. Now, take an example here. Now, take an example wherein you have the property prices, which is hundreds of thousands of dollars, half a million, million, and stuff like that, versus area of the property, which is in few thousands, 2,000, 3,000, 5,000. Now, please note that the scales are different and therefore the covariances can't be compared. Calculating correlation scaled between -1 and 1 can solve this problem. So these were some questions, and obviously we're going to release more and more videos with more and more questions, but these are some good starting questions. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.